going to talk about the Four Noble Truths. What do we mean by noble? Noble means we can actually get back to our Buddha nature. Buddha, when he was a prince, he left the kingdom. He wants to know why there is death. How come we have to suffer? Even as a prince, he has to go through life and death and illness. He's like, I don't want to go through this. Is there any way to end suffering? So he really want to find out, how do we end suffering? So he left the kingdom and sat in the woods and tried to figure it out. At the time, there's a lot of different religions helping him go into meditation. But he found out that's not the answer. Nobody told him why there is suffering. Then for 6 years, he tried to starve himself. Every day, he ate 1 grain of sesame, a little sesame. Okay. So every day he ate 1 grain. He did that for 6 years. And then every day he just sat and meditate, trying to figure out what is the truth about life. One day when he was 30 years old, he sat under the Bodhi tree. He came to full realization. Oh, this is the truth about life. After he realized, oh, this is the truth about life, he started teaching. So 30, he taught to 80. He passed away when he was 80. So he taught for 49 to 50 years. Then he taught, how do we get back to our true Buddha nature? When he first started teaching, this is what he taught. For 49 years, that's what he taught. Mainly, that's what he taught. Okay, so that's the most important Dharma wheel in Buddhism. Okay? The Four Noble Truths, the truth about our lives. So this is what you need to contemplate on in order for you to reach your enlightenment. The first one and the second one is a group. The third and the fourth is a different group. We're trying to go from here to here. That's the purpose. We're going from here to here. And Buddha is very smart. He gave us the result first, then the cause. The result first, then the cause. He doesn't give us the cause and then the result. To let us know how we are right now. What's the cause of it? Just like someone is sick, what's the cause of the sickness? How does he cure himself? Like, what kind of medicine does he take? Okay, so that's the Four Noble Truths. Okay, so the first one is, what is our sickness right now? Okay, so it's called suffering. You have to realize that we live in a world of suffering. There are 3 kinds of sufferings. I wrote it here. So the first one is called ordinary suffering. Ordinary suffering means the suffering that we can all feel. For example, someone hit you, it hurts. That's ordinary, that you know that it's pain, that is suffering. Or you get sick, that's ordinary suffering. A dog would know, you know, a cat would know, everybody would know. Okay, so that's not really a truth or a wisdom, right? But the second kind of suffering is harder to realize. It's called the suffering of changes. Good things will become suffering. If you ate a dumpling, you really like dumpling. You ate one, it tastes very good. If you ate 100, will you still be happy? No, because why? Ate too much. Happiness became suffering. That's called suffering of changes. So you have to realize every happiness eventually will become suffering. So that's the second truth about suffering. Every enjoyment you're having right now, one day it will become bad because it will not last. Everything is impermanent. Okay, impermanence is a top teaching of Buddhism. Okay, so we'll talk about that later. So that's the suffering of changes. The third kind is called pervasive suffering. Pervasive means contamination of our body and mind. Do you guys remember the very first class? We talked about the 5 skandhas. The first one is our form, which is our body. The second one is our feelings. We made up our feelings. We feel hot or cold, or happy or sad, pleasure, displeasure. So that's the second one. The third one is our perception, how we perceive things. You know, that makes up what we think we are, right? And the fourth one is our mental formation. perception going into a deeper level, it becomes a very attached thought. It's called mental formation. The last one is your consciousness. That makes up your body and your mind. Do you realize your five skandhas? They're pervasive. They're always moving, always changing. Is there a moment that you stop your mind? No. It's really hard to stop our mind. So that's a kind of suffering. If you don't meditate, you don't understand how sad it is that we're always having wandering thoughts. It's really a suffering. Like to me, it's a big suffering. So that's called pervasive suffering. Not a lot of people get the second or the third suffering. Everybody only knows the ordinary suffering. So now you need to know all three. When I mean know, I mean you're fully aware of it, fully conscious of it, fully accept it, and deal with it. So it takes a very strong person to know your own suffering, and you can see everybody when everybody is suffering. That's the first truth. You have to know it wholeheartedly, what suffering is. If you don't know it, you don't know how to end it. You have to know it in order to end it. The second noble truth is cause of suffering. Do you know why we keep having sufferings? Why? The main cause is actually because of our own ego, our selfishness. If there's not a concept of self, when someone hit me, would I be upset? No. If I don't exist, then it doesn't hurt, right? It doesn't really affect me. So the main problem is the idea of the ego, of the self, that we take on this identity. When we're born, people taught us, you know, your name is this and that, and this is who you are, and everything about you. Okay, we take on this identity, and then when anybody hurts us, we get upset. This is the cause of why all the suffering comes in. So mainly there are three roots or causes of our ego. The first one is greed. We always want more because there's the idea of self. Okay? Because of me, I want more money, I want more fame, I want more food, you know, I want more sleep, or I want more relationships. Because we're always wanting more. But the fact that you want more is why there's suffering. Okay, if you don't want more, there's no suffering. Okay, so that's the first cause. The second cause is anger. Because you're greedy, if you don't get what you want, it becomes anger. Okay, anything that you want, you don't get. You become angry. Okay, so this two is one after another. Okay, and the third one is ignorance. Not understanding that there's no self. That's our main ignorance. We think we should be selfish because there's real me. My car, my mom, my house, my everything. But that's not me. I am the universal power. I'm the Buddha nature. You are actually the big ocean, but you take on this little bubble as yourself. That's our main ignorance. We don't understand the truth of our lives. That's why we have this kind of result. Because of the cause, we have this result. We're trying to get out of it. We're trying to get out of these two and go here. What's the result that we want to get to? Cessation of suffering, or the ending of suffering. Suffering can end once and for all, nirvana. Or you can call it enlightenment. Or you can call it the let go of the ego, right? There's no ego, there's no suffering. So nirvana is what? It's not a place. It's not a place you go to. It's when you let go of your own ego, then you reach there. You don't really, really have to meditate to reach there. And you don't have to have all these supernatural powers for you to reach nirvana. You know, it's just for you to get this wisdom, to to let go of this ego. That's all. Okay, that's what Buddha realized. We're trying to get to this place where there's no greed, anger, ignorance. That's our purpose. Then you will be ultimately happy, absolute happiness. It's not really duality of happiness, like a happy or good or bad. It's just an absolute happiness. How do we get here? How do we get here? We have to cultivate the fourth one, the path to end suffering. There is a way. The path means a method. What kind of method do we use to reach nirvana? There are three methods that we use in Buddhism. The first one is precepts. The second one is concentration. The third one is wisdom. That's the only three things we try to cultivate in Buddhism. First, we follow precepts. Precepts are rules that Buddha set for his disciples. You follow these rules and you will have less suffering. What are the rules? Okay, there are five basic rules. The first one is no killing. Okay. If you don't kill other beings, you won't have people killing you. You won't have sickness. Sickness comes from your karma, from killing others. That's why we try to be vegetarian. Okay, so first precept is no killing. The second precept is no stealing. That includes taxes or anything, okay? So that includes anything. It's not just, oh, I go steal someone's stuff, you know, no. That includes you lying on the taxes. There's a sale in the mall. Every family gets one free thing, and you have all your five families go there and get five. That's a form of stealing. Okay, it can be very, very small. It can be very, very big, but it all has karma. And it all comes back to you in the form of suffering, sooner or later. Okay, so Buddha said you gotta follow this precept for you to be in happiness without any suffering. It's to protect us. It's not to limit us from doing things. It's to protect us. The third one is no sexual misconduct. When you're married, you don't go outside and have other relationships. It's not proper, but it can be very, very small too. For example, you look at someone you like and you start flirting. Does that count? It does. Even if you didn't do anything, you start to just have more talks. You know, that is also a form of sexual misconduct. Okay. So the fourth one is no lying. When you say things that's exaggeration, you know, like people that sell cars, you know, they say everything. Or so, yeah, everything is a great car, or whatever. So that is still kind of lying. Okay. The fifth is no alcohol. Because when you drink, it's not alcohol itself that is a sin. Because when you're intoxicated, you're more likely to kill, to steal, to have sexual misconduct, and to lie. Okay, that's why he made this rule to prevent from doing the first four. So first, whole precepts, then you're more likely to go into deep concentration. If I have a lot of defilements and I have a lot of these bad karmas, when I sit there, I cannot go into deep concentration because you have a lot of wandering thoughts, and not just wandering thoughts, you have a lot of bad thoughts. Okay, so you guys are all very good people, you know, already, for you to be able to sit here. To go into deep concentration, first you gotta withhold precepts. And then you can go into samadhi or deep concentration. That's what we're doing right now when we're trying to meditate for hours or hours, you know, and persistent at it. This is from persistency. You keep doing it, you'll be good at it. Practice makes perfect. You know, that's what concentration is, okay? So the last one is wisdom. What kind of wisdom? the true wisdom is to understand that there's no self. That's real wisdom. When you can go past yourself, when someone is rude to you, you can actually tell yourself there's not a self that I'm being offended to. If there's not self, who is being offended? Nobody. Okay, so it takes a great person with great wisdom to be able to let go of the self. When you reach this wisdom, or we call enlightenment, you will reach nirvana. This is what we call nirvana. And this is what Buddha did. That's what he did. That's what he accomplished in his life. And that's what he tried to teach us for 49 years. He was in India. He was a real person, a real prince, 2,600 years ago. And his Dharma is still with us today because he's our teacher. Now, we can all go back to our true Buddha nature if we can just start cultivating, let go of the self, and soon enough we will reach nirvana. Everybody can get here, but you have to cultivate. Soon enough, we will be away from all kinds of suffering and all kinds of greed, anger, ignorance, and all the defilements. That's what we're trying to do. Thank you very much for listening. That's it for today.